12 years ago. We were in Israel, Sydney and I. And I wasn't feeling good. I was checked out, I had some tests taken, and the suggestion was that I have to have a bypass, a heart bypass. When I went home, I started thinking, what do I need to do just in case I don't survive? Because my sister didn't survive. So one of the things was the lettuce.
Before the bypass surgery, came July 4th weekend, and she came out to visit my family in Fire Island. We were sitting in my backyard, and I was sitting alone at the table, and she came out and brought me this box.
I said to her, this is what I was hiding. This is what I have. This is something that I never discussed with you before.
What I knew about my mother's past, I can almost describe in terms of items, things. The picture of her parents, the picture of Ala Gardner and my mother. Those two things were very physical evocations of a past, but I had no idea what was beyond them.
I never discussed it with them. I just said, I don't want to talk about it, and there's no purpose in talking about it.
It was as if there was a wall, and you don't try and breach that wall.
I didn't want them to live with any guilt because of what I went through. I didn't want them to hate other people because of what I went through. They meant everything to me. They made connection with the outside world, connection with my family, connection with my friends. It was a feeling that it's worthwhile fighting and hoping not to give up, that we're going to survive. Because there was always that hope, well, if I'm alive, maybe somebody else is alive too.
The letters, when she gave them to me, were all crammed into this. It was just stuffed full of papers, every corner of this box and the pouch, all together like this, sat in this closet in Queens, and then in Muncie, just silently waiting for somebody to come and lock it. So this is a complete set of the letters. They are all here, every single one, including the envelopes.
Oh my God.
And includes all your birthday cards.
Oh,
right? This was always my favorite one. Yeah, you should live to 120.
Oh my God.
From the minute I touched the letters, I knew that they were going to be an important part of my future. I feel this compulsion to be able to tell her story. I'm proud of you and will always be. And however you go on with your life, think always of me and go through life in a way that would make me content.
Don't cry, Danny. Oh. Don't, honey. Don't. That was a long time, honey.
Now she writes to Harry.
It's stressful because there's so much that I don't remember and I can't find the words for it. Because I really don't want to remember no more. I really don't want to. Because then it haunts me at night.
I don't know all the words, but we'll fake it.
So you can do background beat.
So here is Kim and Aquafina.
Hey! Hey! Hey!
Are you just giving up? kuzmina bekalafiot de pomeransin face left with maidens of tintansin bekalafiot de pomeransin face left with maidens of tintansin. There's five more
bars. So
whoever survived the camps are really great people. I don't think people realize how great they were to be able to do the things that they did and survive and still be and still make it in a normal world. It wasn't hard for me to fall in love, because she was young, beautiful. One thing she always made sure that I wasn't loving her or being with her out of pity. And I had to tell her many times, no, I love you for being yourself. I did the best job I could. Took care of her, I am taking care of her, and will continue to take care of her, because I love the girl. I mean, let's put it in the simplest terms.
The inner workings of my grandmother's mind just completely and utterly baffle me, because I just don't understand how she does it, because I can't, and I feel like, I mean, people tend to think that young people, I guess, are more resilient, that we can bounce back better, and that we're, you know, our minds are more flexible, but I can't do that. What I love most about this story is that it showed that in the face of these terrible things that were happening, life will still go on. Her niece writes her with the, she like had practiced her letters, and it's in one of the letters, and her niece died, I think, in Auschwitz. Every time I think about that, it makes me want to cry.
So you don't remember it at all?
Not at all. I don't remember writing it. I don't remember having it. So, maybe when I'll start reading it, it'll. But
it'll,
I don't remember. I have no recollection, no, really.
Everything else we've looked at is somebody else's voice. Right. But now with the diary, you come center stage, so we can hear you speaking for the first time. So I was very excited about that. Here.
Yeah, that's my handwriting.
It's dated October 28th, 1940. And I remembered that date because I remember you said that was the day that you went away from home.
Dear Father, will you miss you, Sarah? Like, see, he called me Sarah.
Mm-hmm.
The intolerable girl. I was a tough one. I was a rebel a little bit. My father cried. Yes, he did cry when we were saying goodbye. And with all my sweet girlfriends, we started out, where to, why, only the future would. That's hard.
I tried to keep a smile on my face as best I could, but my eyes were filled with tears. One must go on bravely and courageously, even if the heart is breaking.
There was a time where I wanted to not be Jewish anymore. But then I said, but my parents died because of the faith. How can I betray them? and not be Jewish anymore. Sometimes I get very angry, especially when I was away in camps. I would get angry sometimes, very angry. I came out, I have nobody around, the whole family. We would have been maybe 100 people now, from all the sisters and brothers, and we are not. And that makes you angry, right? Why? There's no answer to it. But I have faith. I don't know what it is, but I'm holding on to it.